My name is Robert Drysdale, and I'm here performing and making art in Romania. I have been invited here by the same artists that were working in my residency program in the United States, the PAI, Performance Art Institute, which is a nonprofit, and we host and showcase artists internationally. And I met Elena Albu, Lucien Alexei, and my friend whose apartment this is, whose home this is, Gilly McConnell. He has put me up here for 4 months to create sound works and to make painting, because we both kind of do the same thing. This is a painting that I made from a shot that was taken on Mount Everest recently in the past 50 years, or 20 years rather. Of a man that died, the first man that committed himself to climbing the tallest earthen object on the planet. And he died doing it. The name is Arms Akimbo of this painting, which is on the wall over here. It means arms in a keen bow. So when you stand in a photograph, it used to be that you position one leg forward to create a more figurative shape, and you'd put your arms in a bow, like when you draw a bow. You have that bow. So you have a keen, which means good or cool or awesome, a keen bow, really cool bow. And he stood at the mountain in a picture, in a photograph before this photograph, his last photograph, and staring at the camera with a group of men that had been challenged to do this thing, climb up Mount Everest. And I see it as the task of life. I see it as the task of man to accomplish something that they set out, the big deal, the big thing. Marina does it. How can I challenge myself? Matthew Barney does it. How do I make the best film I can make? And I'm not a cinematographer. And he challenged himself. He made the Cream Masters. But he's bowing down now to the mountain. He's submitting to the mountain. He lost. He lost the battle. And I think that's wonderful. I think that an artist can lose. An artist or a man can lose, or a woman can lose the battle. But they try. They tried to do it, and the attempt is where it's at. When I first really started, I was probably like three years old. And my mom put me in special classes to draw, to paint, to make sculptures, to do stuff, and I was doing that for years. I was sort of a New York kid with my dad working on Wall Street, working in the late 70s, mid 70s. And we moved to Pittsburgh in 1990, 1989. And when I was in art school, which I attended from 1999 till 2003 at the Art Center College of Design in Pasadena, California, where, you know, a few artists, Jorge Pardo, Doug Aiken, Jennifer Steinkamp, Jenny Holzer, some other people, and there's some great teachers there. Mike Kelly, who's a performance artist as well, and Marina was one of my teachers. She's very stern, she's funny, she has a sexuality to her that is, you know, unprecedented in a 65-year-old woman, in my opinion. Marina, I went to the Marina Abramovic Institute when it was still Marina Abramovic Institute, and I got hired. It wasn't really hired, it was more like acquired through Stephen, befriending him. Stephen and I bonded in a lot of different ways. To keep doing shit like that and do it over and over and over again, I think it becomes fucking insane. And I feel like I already am insane. And I like to find some sort of clarity and some sort of shamanistic, like, point of light, third eye shit. You don't go down the same route. You're not fucking Banksy and painting ironic bullshit on stuff that, you know, any moron can get. You're trying to achieve something else. The mystery schools of Egypt. You're trying to be beyond ourselves, be in some sort of fourth dimensional thing, transitional space. My influences in music stem from my early childhood. I obviously listened to American pop music, the Beach Boys, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Led Zeppelin. And then I got a little older. There's a lot of different types of influences that I have in the creation of music. Jim Hawkinson from Los Angeles is in a band with Toby Dammit, who plays with Iggy Pop. And then one day they were talking to me about 8 years ago, and they said, "Hey man, you got to listen to this guy Ariel Pink." And it took me a while to kind of catch on and to be, you know, privy to all the different nuances of the music. So to say that that's probably one of my strongest influences is true, and it's definitely somebody that I admire a lot. Born of woman, mental man, change me, I'm changing day to day. You know, and I think that most people are just vessels for music. We most hear it, we regurgitate it, and it comes out. And then I use guitar, I use drums, bass, keyboard, synth, found sound, field recordings. To look at artists and morality, and to look at artists and artist rights and personal rights, personal freedoms, performance, and what that raises with the general public that are not privy or in on the joke, if you will, of the performance or the activity that's being done as art form. You know, you could talk about cannibalism and taboo and, you know, what's wrong and right and morality and what's looked at in society as generally wrong or distasteful. I believe in no taste. I believe in that as an artist, you should have no taste. You have to be completely objective. You have to put yourself into it and then put yourself out of it and then look and put yourself into other people's positions. There's an artist, I guess, Rick Gibson, that has been very controversial over the past 20 some years, doing performances with animals, doing performances with human flesh. He's taking human flesh and eating it, and he's providing us the scenario in which we talk about it, in which we bring out the taboo into the main dance floor area, fetishizing things that you can't have, drugs, sex, certain activities, going places, borders that are created, walls that are created. People always want to go up and over those walls.
Now, is that it? Is that the final thing? You know, is that just because we can't do it, that's why it has to be done? That's the question that'll be left up for time to tell.
Living is much, much more difficult. Raising up every morning and not knowing what's going to be the night's bringing, it's much more difficult. It's much more difficult.
I just want to say something to everyone that I see that is standing around and crying. This is nothing to cry about. This is something we should all rejoice about. We should be happy about this.
Being from San Francisco, you know, Jim Jones is from there. Jim Jones was a community leader, created his own version of socialism / religion, as he is a prophet, he is God, and brought his people and followers in to his group, his church, manipulating them when they were in the San Francisco cult together in the same house living together. Jim Jones had acquired the position of a councilman for city planning or something of that nature in San Francisco, and he used black people and their ills and strifes throughout the 60s into the 70s as sort of the catalyst to bring them on board.
Please let it go, let it go. Jane, I see you're suffering over there. Don't worry, it's okay, please.
Jim, I just want to say that Jim put us in line and gave us everything that we have today, and I think what Manny was saying was really fucked up and ain't right, because whatever we have from Jim.
We have given up. The problem is now on us. We have to go. We have to leave this world right now.
I ain't trying to talk to you about that, no, Jim.
Listen. Organize everybody. We need to organize everybody, and we need to do this quickly. We do not have that much time, everyone. We do not have any time.
Okay, so basically, Jim took those people, took 1,000 people, and over that sequence of 1 hour of his manipulative talk, his speech, he got them to drink and to imbibe cyanide poisoning in Kool-Aid.
Please get us some medication. It's simple. There's no convulsions with it. It's just simple. Just please get it. Before it's too late, the GDF will be here. I tell you, get moving. Yeah. Don't be afraid to die. If these people land out here, they'll torture some of our children here.
There's a lot of different things that I look at that with Jim Jones. And you know, playing my music and Geely's music over top of it, and as poetry, as a way to look at human beings in their occult manner, and the different ways that has come about, and how that snuck up on us, and how that sort of definitely changed the face of our society today. And that's what I love about the occult, and that's what I love about art. And it's like something that you can believe in, just like the occult, and just be so into it and so emotionally pulled by it.
Yes, master. My precious.
I don't want to die. I don't want to kiss her.
Shut up, you fat cow!
Put yourself together, man.
Pull yourself together, you fat cow!
Be your dog, but now I wanna be your dog.
I don't know, Nando.